death. We don't talk about death that much, do we? Death has become that taboo topic that no one likes to talk about. We use words like so-and-so had passed on to avoid using the word die. We are uncomfortable with the idea of writing our will. We don't even buy a HDB flat on the fourth floor because the number four literally sounds like death in Chinese. We dislike it so much that in 2014, there was a campaign to initiate end-of-life conversations, or they call it dialogues, with older Singaporeans called Dai Dai Must Say, 死都要讲. But because death is no respecter of age, gender, or race, it is never too early a time to think or talk about it. This is especially pertinent today where COVID deaths run in the thousands worldwide. Every day we are confronting death, and everyone will struggle with the finality of the grave. Today's I Am statement arose from an episode of death. Within it, we find one of the most prominent I Am statements, a statement that can be commonly found on the backdrop of a wake or funeral. The fifth statement of our series, Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. And this is found in John chapter 11. But today, I will focus on verses 17 to 27. And it reads, Now when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off. Many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him. But Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you. Jesus said to her, Your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he dies, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this morning. Guide us, O Lord, by your word and your Holy Spirit, that in your light we may see light, in your truth find freedom, and in your will discover peace and hope through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So what is the context? In the earlier part of John 11, Jesus had heard that his good friend was sick. But instead of going to visit Lazarus, Jesus stayed where he was for 2 more days. And he explained to his puzzled disciples that the sickness was for God's glory, that God's Son may be glorified through it. After Lazarus died, Jesus went to Lazarus' home, and that's where we are right now in a passage today. But fast forward to the end of the chapter, we know that Jesus eventually did raise Lazarus from the dead. But what does I am the resurrection and the life mean in light of raising of Lazarus from the dead? Well, fundamentally, Jesus is talking about our bodily resurrection in the last days. That is, the eternal life that we look forward to. After Jesus' I am statement in verse 25, he followed up with his explanation and he says, Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Well, actually, he's essentially saying the same thing in both these sentences, but with a subtle difference. Whoever believes in him, though he suffers a physical death, will live in the afterlife. And those who live believing in him will experience a continuity into eternity. So when Jesus told Martha in verse 23 that your brother will rise again, Martha replied saying, I know he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. That is not wrong, because that was the prevailing belief of an eventual spiritual resurrection. But Jesus makes a startling claim, saying that he is the resurrection, and he is pointing to a bodily resurrection of all who believed in him. You see, the second clue can be derived from the use of the Greek word zoe, which means life, of which my second daughter's name came from. The use of zoe in the Gospel of John is almost always alluding to eternal life. Not just life, but eternal life. That is why in our Nicene Creed, we profess that we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. And so I think when Jesus says in 11:25-26, it's perhaps an alluding to his impending death and resurrection as well, and the resurrection of the believers to come. But there's a slight problem. How then do we explain the immediate raising of Lazarus, since Jesus is talking about a later resurrection? Sometimes we focus too much on the future resurrection that he has led some people to think, if the afterlife is so good, then I'd rather die now. One of my lecturers once said, we are so heaven-minded that we are of no earthly good. So what is the significance of the I am statement in light of Lazarus' death? Perhaps it was also to demonstrate Jesus' power in our present reality, in the here and now. Here, we find that Lazarus is dead, very dead. The mention of 4 days suggests a reference to the popular Jewish belief that when a person dies, the soul departs finally from the body after 3 days. And so within these 3 days, the soul may have a chance to jump back in and resurrect, as it were. And so there's a practice for Jewish people to visit the tomb of a newly buried person for 3 days to ensure that the person was really dead. But here, we're looking at 4 days. John is trying to tell us that Lazarus is truly dead. And when Jesus raised him up, it was not merely a miracle of resuscitation, but a resurrection from the realm of the dead. A feat that no one can claim but God himself. Martha had viewed this future resurrection as something distant and remote when she said, I know he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day, in verse 24. But she completely missed the fact that the true source of life and resurrection was standing right in front of her. When Jesus said, your brother will rise again, in the previous verse, he was perhaps referring to what he was about to do in the present reality. What does it mean for us today? If someone dies today, know that Jesus can raise that person to life. Not that he will, but he can. Sometimes we focus too much on the future, that we forget about the current power that Jesus has in this world. We must remember that the kingdom of God is already here, and the eternal life begins now. Beasley Moray puts it this way, the revelation to Martha is an assurance of resurrection to the kingdom of God in its consummation through him who is the resurrection, and of life in the kingdom of God in the present time through him who is the life. So yes, the statement could be Jesus pointing to both the current and future reality. But as I dug deeper, I realized when Jesus made the statement, the focal point was not on when, but rather who. Why do I say that? You see, the Greek words for I am finds its roots in the Hebrew words I am who I am in the Old Testament. That's when God was speaking to Moses in Exodus 3:14. In the Hebrew language, the words I am emphasizes the perpetual being of God. He is a continuous being, irrespective of time. So when Jesus uses the I am statement, he is alluding to that Hebrew term. And it similarly implies that like God, Jesus is the same, whether in the past, present, or in the future. So may I propose to you that Jesus is not really directing our attention to the time aspect here in this statement, but rather he is drawing our attention to himself as the source of the resurrection and the life. He is not just a representative of it. He is it. He is not merely claiming to be it. He proved it. And after this, he's saying, all you have to do is trust me. Believe in me. You see, there are different layers of belief and faith, the themes of belief and faith in the Gospel of John. And we find this recurring challenge or question, do you believe? Is almost always linked to all the I am statements. From I am the bread of life, I am the light of the world, the door, the good shepherd, and now for the fifth time, I am the resurrection and the life. So having proved all this, would you believe me? It is as though Jesus is saying in the RSV translation, Rufus Singaporean version, what gali gong gui bai liao? What do you see he call? This song sing bo. Translated in English, I tell you many times already, I am the one. You believe or not? All my life, I have said yes to that question. Until 4 years ago, when tragedy struck in the family. There had been a death in the family, and honestly, I had never lost someone close to me in my life before. And that was the first time I ever experienced death up close. I began to think about the mortality of life. Perhaps it was coinciding with what is commonly known as midlife crisis. I started to fear death. You know how when you were much younger, a little bit more carefree, you can do bungee jumping, skydiving, ride a motorbike, parkour all you want without a care in the world. But as you age, you grow in commitments and possessions. You are committed to your family, your children. You have a house. You build a company. Your career is taking off. You have a good life, and you don't want to lose it. And soon after, the words YOLO don't apply anymore, and you just stop taking unnecessary risks. The fear of death is understandable. More than just thinking about death, I started to doubt. What if this entire Christian enterprise is not real? Then I would have been living in a lie all my life. If Jesus is not real, that means the end of life is a termination point, not a transition. That was a scary thought for me. I was going through an existential crisis. And the irony is that about a half a year later, I entered TTC, seminary. Contrary to my own expectation that I would be able to get rid of all these doubts in TTC and grow in my faith, I did not. In fact, it got worse. TTC began to deconstruct what I know all my life. I struggled with the understanding of the church's dark historical past. I struggled with the historicity of some Old Testament texts and the schisms the church has had over theologies. And before I know it, I was progressively becoming faithless. I pressed on with my studies, plowing through writing papers after papers. Plenty in my head cannot compensate for the emptiness in the heart. I knew that there is a God-shaped void that only Jesus could feel. I began praying for a spiritual revival in my life. And that experience eventually came. It was the faith of a youth that inspired my faith again. At my auntie's wake service, my cousin's son gave a eulogy for his grandmother, and he said these finest words. If anyone tells you that Ama is dead, don't believe. She is alive. In fact, she is more alive than any one of us. Referring to Romans 8, he later said, the same power of the resurrected Christ is with Ama now. I don't know why, but that was exactly what I needed to hear. Not just the words, but the conviction reminded me of my own faith years ago. From the faith of a 17-year-old, I rekindled mine. From a doubter, I became a believer once more. I am convinced and convicted that when I die, I will be in eternity with God. But while I live no longer fearing death. You see, the purpose of John 11 is so that we may believe. What is significant is when Martha replied Jesus, the words, I believe, are in perfect tense, indicating a faith that is fixed and settled. Now, the perfect tense in Greek is intriguing because it refers to an action that is completed in the past, but also has a continuing effect. It is as though Martha is saying, I have believed and I will continue to believe. So my friends, the issue is not about when the resurrection will take place. It is about the person of Jesus who has the power over death and life, present and future. When I place my faith in Jesus who has power over death and life, I can be assured and I no longer need to be afraid. I am the resurrection and the life. There is no resurrection apart from Christ. Likewise, there is no eternal life apart from Christ. The issue is therefore in the question, and the question is issued. Do you believe? And will you continue to believe? I don't know how many of you are struggling with your faith today. As life trudges on, some of us may be feeling tired of living, losing the purpose of it all day by day. Some of us are busy with building earthly treasures that perhaps are drawing us further away from God. Perhaps we are jaded. Perhaps we are losing our purpose to live. And there may be some of us who love life too much that we fear losing it all. We fear our impending death. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. Because of that, death is no longer needs to be a taboo. We no longer need to fear death. We can revel in life and celebrate death. Believe in the resurrected person of Jesus and live a life of hope and purpose in the current reality and look forward to the extension of this current reality into the future glory. And may your response be like Martha's and say, I believe today. Amen.